Charles Grey, 2nd Earl Grey, known as Viscount Howick between 1806 and 1807, was a British politician who served as Prime Minister of the United Kingdom from November 1830 to July 1834. He was a descendant of the noble House of Grey and a member of the Whig Party. Grey was a long-time leader of multiple reform movements, and as Prime Minister, his government was known for bringing about two notable reforms. The Reform Act 1832 brought about parliamentary reform, bringing changes to the House of Commons. His government also enacted the Slavery Abolition Act 1833, bringing about the abolition of slavery in most of the British Empire. Grey was a strong opponent of the foreign and domestic policies of William Pitt the Younger in the 1790s. In 1807, he resigned as Foreign Secretary to protest against King George III's uncompromising rejection of Catholic emancipation. Grey finally resigned in 1834 over disagreements in his cabinet regarding Ireland, and retired from politics. Scholars rank him highly among British prime ministers, believing that he averted much civil strife and enabled Victorian progress. Earl Grey T is named after him. Chapter 1, Early Life. Descended from a long-established Northumbrian family seated at Howick Hall, Grey was the second but eldest surviving son of General Charles Grey KB and his wife, Elizabeth, daughter of George Grey of Southwick, Co. Durham. He had four brothers and two sisters. He was educated at Richmond School, followed by Eton and Trinity College, Cambridge, acquiring a facility in Latin and in English composition and declamation that enabled him to become one of the foremost parliamentary orators of his generation. Chapter 2, Titles. He became the 2nd Earl Grey, Viscount Howick and Baron Grey of Howick on the 14th of November 1807 upon the death of his father. Upon the death of his uncle on the 30th of March 1808 he became the 3rd Baronet Grey of Howick. Chapter 3, Government Career. Chapter 4, Section 1, Elected to Parliament, 1786. Grey was elected to Parliament for the Northumberland constituency on the 14th of September 1786, aged just 22. He became a part of the Whig circle of Charles James Fox, Richard Brinsley Sheridan, and the Prince of Wales, and soon became one of the major leaders of the Whig Party. He was the youngest manager on the committee for prosecuting Warren Hastings. The Whig historian T.B. Macaulay wrote in 1841, "At an age when most of those who distinguish themselves in life are still contending for prizes and fellowships at college, he had won for himself a conspicuous place in Parliament. No advantage of fortune or connection was wanting that could set off to the height his splendid talents and his unblemished honour. At 23 he had been thought worthy to be ranked with the veteran statesmen who appeared as the delegates of the British Commons, at the bar of the British nobility. All who stood at that bar, save him alone, are gone, culprit, advocates, accusers. To the generation which is now in the vigour of life, he is the sole representative of a great age which has passed away. But those who, within the last 10 years, have listened with delight, till the morning sun shone on the tapestries of the House of Lords, to the lofty and animated eloquence of Charles Earl Grey, are able to form some estimate of the powers of a race of men among whom he was not the foremost." Grey was also noted for advocating parliamentary reform and Catholic emancipation. His affair with Georgiana Cavendish, Duchess of Devonshire, herself an active political campaigner, did him little harm, although it nearly caused her to be divorced by her husband. Chapter 4, Section 2, Foreign Secretary, 1806-1807. In 1806, Grey, by then Lord Howick owing to his father's elevation to the peerage as Earl Grey, became a part of the Ministry of All the Talents as First Lord of the Admiralty. Following Fox's death later that year, Howick took over both as Foreign Secretary and as leader of the Whigs. The ministry broke up in 1807 when George III blocked Catholic emancipation legislation and required that all ministers individually sign a pledge, which Howick refused to do, that they would not propose any further concessions to the Catholics. Chapter 4, Section 3, Years in Opposition, 1807 to 1830. The government fell from power the next year, and, after a brief period as a Member of Parliament for Appleby from May to July 1807, Howick went to the Lords, succeeding his father as Earl Grey. He continued in opposition for the next 23 years. There were times during this period when Grey came close to joining the government. In 1811, the Prince Regent tried to court Grey and his ally William Grenville to join the Spencer Perceval ministry following the resignation of Lord Wellesley. Grey and Grenville declined because the Prince Regent refused to make concessions regarding Catholic emancipation. Grey's relationship with the Prince was strained further when his estranged daughter and heiress, Princess Charlotte, turned to him for advice on how to avoid her father's choice of husband for her. On the Napoleonic Wars, Grey took the standard Whig party line. After being initially enthused by the Spanish uprising against Napoleon, Grey became convinced of the French Emperor's invincibility following the defeat and death of Sir John Moore, the leader of the British forces in the Peninsular War. Grey was then slow to recognize the military successes of Moore's successor, the Duke of Wellington. When Napoleon first abdicated in 1814, Grey objected to the restoration of the Bourbons' authoritarian monarchy, and when Napoleon was reinstalled the following year, he said that the change was an internal French matter. In 1826, believing that the Whig Party no longer paid any attention to his opinions, Grey stood down as leader in favour of Lord Lansdowne. The following year, when George Canning succeeded Lord Liverpool as Prime Minister, it was therefore Lansdowne and not Grey who was asked to join the government, which needed strengthening following the resignations of Robert Peel and the Duke of Wellington. When Wellington became Prime Minister in 1828, George IV singled out Grey as the one person he could not appoint to the government. Chapter 4, Section 4, Prime Minister. In 1830, following the death of George IV and when the Duke of Wellington resigned on the question of parliamentary reform, the Whigs finally returned to power, with Grey as Prime Minister. In 1831, he was made a member of the Order of the Garter. His term was a notable one, seeing passage of the Reform Act 1832, which finally saw the reform of the House of Commons, and the abolition of slavery throughout almost all of the British Empire in 1833 with the Slavery Abolition Act. As the years had passed, however, Grey had become more conservative, and he was cautious about initiating more far-reaching reforms, particularly since he knew that the King was at best only a reluctant supporter of reform. Grey contributed to a plan to found a new colony in South Australia, in 1831 a proposal to His Majesty's government for founding a colony on the southern coast of Australia was prepared under the auspices of Robert Gouger, Anthony Bacon, Jeremy Bentham, and Grey. But its ideas were considered too radical, and it was unable to attract the required investment. In the same year, Grey was appointed to serve on the Government Commission upon Emigration. It was the issue of Ireland which precipitated the end of Grey's premiership in 1834. Lord Anglesey, the Viceroy of Ireland, preferred conciliatory reform including the partial redistribution of the income from the church tithe to the Catholic Church and away from the established Protestant one, a policy known as appropriation. The Chief Secretary for Ireland, Lord Stanley, however, preferred coercive measures. The cabinet was divided, and when Lord John Russell drew attention in the House of Commons to their differences over appropriation, Stanley and others resigned. This triggered Grey to retire from public life, leaving Lord Melbourne as his successor. Unlike most politicians, he seems to have genuinely preferred a private life. Colleagues remarked caustically that he threatened to resign at every setback. Grey returned to Howick but kept a close eye on the policies of the new cabinet under Melbourne, whom he, and especially his family, regarded as a mere understudy until he began to act in ways of which they disapproved. Grey became more critical as the decade went on, being particularly inclined to see the hand of Daniel O'Connell behind the scenes and blaming Melbourne for subservience to the radicals with whom he identified the Irish Patriot. He made no allowances for Melbourne's need to keep the radicals on his side to preserve his shrinking majority in the Commons, and in particular he resented any slight on his own great achievement, the Reform Act, which he saw as a final solution of the question for the foreseeable future. He continually stressed its conservative nature. As he declared in his last great public speech, at the Grey Festival organized in his honor at Edinburgh, September 1834, its purpose was to strengthen and preserve the established constitution, to make it more acceptable to the people at large, and especially the middle classes, who had been the principal beneficiaries of the Reform Act, and to establish the principle that future changes would be gradual, according to the increased intelligence of the people, and the necessities of the times. It was the speech of a conservative statesman. Chapter 4, Section 5, Subsection 1, Lord Grey's Ministry, November 1830, July 1834. Lord Grey, First Lord of the Treasury and Leader of the House of Lords. Lord Brougham, Lord Chancellor. Lord Lansdowne, Lord President of the Council. Lord Durham, Lord Privy Seal. Lord Melbourne, Secretary of State for the Home Department. Lord Palmerston, Secretary of State for Foreign Affairs. Lord Goderich, Secretary of State for War and the Colonies. Sir James Graham, First Lord of the Admiralty. Lord Althorpe, Chancellor of the Exchequer and Leader of the House of Commons. Charles Grant, President of the Board of Control. Lord Holland, Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster. The Duke of Richmond, Postmaster General. Lord Carlisle, Minister without Portfolio. Changes. June 1831, Lord John Russell, the Paymaster of the Forces, and Edward Smith Stanley, the Chief Secretary for Ireland, join the Cabinet. April 1833, Lord Goderich, now Lord Ripon, succeeds Lord Durham as Lord Privy Seal. Edward Smith Stanley succeeds Ripon as Secretary of State for War and the Colonies. His successor as Chief Secretary for Ireland is not in the Cabinet. Edward Ellis, the Secretary at War, joins the Cabinet. June 1834, Thomas Spring Rice succeeds Stanley as Colonial Secretary. Lord Carlisle succeeds Ripon as Lord Privy Seal. Lord Auckland succeeds Graham as First Lord of the Admiralty. The Duke of Richmond leaves the Cabinet. His successor as Postmaster General is not in the Cabinet. Charles Paulet Thompson, the President of the Board of Trade, and James Abercrombie, the Master of the Mint, join the Cabinet. Chapter 4, Personal Life. Before his marriage, Grey had an affair with the married Georgiana Cavendish, Duchess of Devonshire. Grey met Cavendish while attending a Whig society meeting in Devonshire House, and they became lovers. In 1791 she became pregnant and was sent to France, where she gave birth to an illegitimate daughter, who was raised by Grey's parents. Eliza Courtney. She married Robert Ellis. Chapter 5, Section 1, Marriage and Legitimate Children. On the 18th of November 1794, Grey married Mary Elizabeth Ponsonby, only daughter of William Ponsonby, 1st Baron Ponsonby of Immokalee and Honourable Louisa Molesworth. The marriage was a fruitful one. Between 1796 and 1819 the couple had 10 sons and 6 daughters. Unnamed daughter Grey. Lady Louisa Elizabeth Grey. She married John Lambton, 1st Earl of Durham, on the 9th of December 1816. They had 5 children, including Charles William, Grey's favourite grandson, who died young. Lady Elizabeth Grey. She married John Crocker Baltiel on the 13th of May 1826. They had 5 children. Lady Caroline Grey. She married Captain Honourable George Barrington on the 15th of January 1827. They had 2 children. Lady Georgiana Grey, who never married. Henry George Grey, 3rd Earl Grey. He married Maria Copley on the 9th of August 1832. General Charles Grey. He married Caroline Farquhar on the 26th of July 1836. They had 7 children, including Albert Grey, 4th Earl Grey. Admiral Sir Frederick William Grey. He married Barbarina Sullivan on the 20th of July 1846. Lady Mary Grey. She married Charles Wood, 1st Viscount Halifax, on the 29th of July 1829. They had seven children. The Honourable William Grey, who died at the age of six. Admiral the Honourable George Grey. He married Jane Stuart on the 20th of January 1845. They had 11 children. Thomas Grey, who died at the age of 15. Reverend John Grey M.A., D.D., Canon and Rector of Durham. He married Lady Georgiana Hervey in July 1836. They had three children. He remarried Helen Spaulding on the 11th of April 1874. Reverend Francis Richard Grey. He married Lady Elizabeth Howard, daughter of George Howard, 6th Earl of Carlisle on the 12th of August 1840. Captain the Honourable Henry Cavendish Grey. William George Grey. He married Theresa Steddink on the 20th of September 1858. Chapter 5 Section 2, Later Years and Death. Grey spent his last years in contented, if sometimes fretful, retirement at Howick with his books, his family, and his dogs. The one great personal blow he suffered in old age was the death of his favourite grandson, Charles, at the age of 13. Grey became physically feeble in his last years and died quietly in his bed on the 17th of July 1845, 44 years to the day since going to live at Howick. He was buried in the Church of St. Michael and All Angels there on the 26th in the presence of his family, close friends, and the labourers on his estate. His biographer G.M. Trevelyan argues. In our domestic history, 1832 is the next great landmark after 1688, saved the land from revolution and civil strife and made possible the quiet progress of the Victorian era. Chapter 5, Legacy. Grey is commemorated by Grey's Monument in the centre of Newcastle-upon-Tyne, which consists of a statue of Lord Grey standing atop a 40 metres high column. The monument was damaged by lightning in 1941 and the statue's head was knocked off. The monument lends its name to Monument Metro Station on the Tyne and Wear Metro, located directly underneath. Grey Street in Newcastle-upon-Tyne, which runs southeast from the monument, is also named after Grey. Durham University's Grey College is named after Grey, who as Prime Minister in 1832 supported the Act of Parliament that established the university. Earl Grey Tea, a blend which uses bergamot oil to flavour the brew, is named after Grey. Chapter 6, Section 1, in film. Grey is portrayed by Dominic Cooper in the 2008 film The Duchess, directed by Saul Dibb and starring Keira Knightley and Ralph Fiennes. The film is based on Amanda Foreman's biography of Georgiana Cavendish, Duchess of Devonshire. Chapter 6, Section 2, Other Sources. Moseley, Charles, Burke's Peerage and Baronetage of Great Britain and Ireland, Cassells. A. Another, A Dictionary of Arts, Sciences, Literature and General Information, Encyclopædia Britannica, New York, retrieved 10 May 2008. Moseley, Charles, Charles Moseley, Burke's Peerage and Baronetage. 10 Downing Street website, PMs in History, archived from the original on the 25th of August, 2008, retrieved the 26th of July, 2006. Temperley, Harold and L. M. Penson, eds. Foundations of British Foreign Policy, From Pitt to Salisbury, Primary Sources Online.